Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We're going to finish up this week's theme of hard rock and look at a track that is rather recent. I'm really hoping that they're continuing on with some of the sounds that we've listened to this week that have come out in the 70s and 80s, but I find it very interesting that we have looked at songs primarily from those two decades, and this one came out in the 2010s, early 2010s even. So let's dive into this. The band is called The Sword. The song is called Cloak of Feathers. Let's see what they're bringing to the table. Yeah, feels a lot like Led Zeppelin with modern production. Really loving that bass presence, something I've spoken about all week actually. She wore a cloak of feathers and rode a mare of purest white. A silver chalice in her hands, a look of sadness in her eyes. A thing of beauty to behold, but a sorrow to burn. Oh, interesting variation on the riff. She'll take all that you offer until there's nothing left. Nothing left. Interesting. Allow the song to chill out and breathe a little bit in this chorus. Oh, that was a subtle tom roll. Yeah. Giving both the drums and the bass a moment to shine here. And even bring in a little bit of a... Oh, very interesting section then. Another one of those wide tom rolls. Yep, okay. Right now we have an ABCB or ABCAB pattern. I'm really interested what comes in next. Right? this back. Oh, but with more drive. Yeah, the drums are really hitting on every beat now. Especially that cymbal is really filling in a lot of the space that was left over in the original run as well. All right. Yeah, so 100%, you know, there's a couple of tells, a couple of giveaways that this is a modern band, but aside from mostly the texture, right, the production of it all, which is a bit more modern, there's a lot of ideas in here that I think fit in very well with what we've listened to this week, especially, like I mentioned, Led Zeppelin. I think this fits in very perfectly with what we heard this week from them. So we have the main riff idea, which is sitting on a single note and then tying it up with a lick at the end of the phrase. So here we have this one note that dun dun, and then the second time around it goes da dun dun, and we stay on that note for a little bit. In the second half of it, we get the run, the da 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 yeah. So we have this idea of the pedal note versus the lick, and that's what our riff is made up of. This is what I've been talking about all week, and we can see this core idea of how to compose the primary guitar phrase being found in this song that ties back to you know, how music was, or how this type of music was being created at the time. Although I should also say that that is an oversimplification, possibly. I have a very narrow view of this hard rock genre. I've heard other songs from some of the bands we've checked out this week. And, you know, I used to listen to a lot of classic rock radio. So I do have a larger experience with this genre outside of the four or five songs we've checked out this week. But I've also really only listened to the big hits. I don't know many of the non-singles from these bands. None of the large songs that everybody knows from them. So it could very well be that this idea that I'm kind of basing this on, this core idea of how to build a hard rock riff, is based on a small section of the genre. But with my experience with it, this is exactly what I think of when you say hard rock. This is the kind of riff I'm thinking of. It's also interesting that there's so much space being put here as well. This is something that we saw on Cult of Personality, something we saw on Black Dog, something we saw on Black Sabbath. Yeah, Iron Man had this too, where the riff and the vocals are not always going off at the same time. In fact, there's large sections, usually a bar, a full bar, where there's no instrument going and the vocals are singing. We saw that numerous times this week as well. I never really associated that with hard rock, but the more I think about it, there's a lot of popular songs that utilize that that compositional idea as well. You do the riff, then you lay down some vocals. You do the riff, then you lay down some vocals. And occasionally there'll be some carryover. And sometimes you, like in this song, on the we would hear the core riff and then they would hold out a note for two bars or two beats, I think. And then the next two beats are silence for the vocals to fill in. So it's not the entirety of the vocals that are sung against silence. It's half of each line, with the first half having a single guitar or a single note, maybe a power chord being played under it, and then the second half of the vocals being sung against silence. But this idea of giving space to the vocals is definitely a very hard rock idea. And then converting the riff to the chords, which is what we see here, is something that we've seen throughout this week as well. We saw it in Fireball yesterday, where the chorus is where the guitars just play the chords. Here, they actually took it down a little bit. I don't think we've listened to anything this week where the intensity dropped a bit, but I don't think it would be unprecedented for the genre to have that. But it is really cool to have that sort of change up this week, comparing it to the other four tracks we've checked out for the theme. A lot of the energy, a lot of the memorable stuff from these bands does come from the iconic riffs. And an interesting way, I think, of maybe contextualizing that to ensure that the riff becomes iconic is to bring the intensity down. So the part that everybody really associates strongly with the song is going to be the verse, and the verse has the riff in it. When I think of Cloak of Feathers in the future, I'm not going to think about, the smoother chorus. I'm going to think about the verse, because that's where a lot of the things that I think about hard rock exist in. And that's going to make me remember the riff, which is going to tie the riff to the song, which is going to make it not necessarily iconic in the sense that whenever I hear anything even remotely close to it, I'm going to think of it. You know, not like the Iron Man riff, but it could be, you know, in 20 years that this riff does become very iconic to this song. And the sword ends up seeing, themselves being tied to this riff, much like some of the iconic riffs that we tie with, hard rock bands from the 70s and 80s. It is interesting, too, though, come to think of this. Iconic riffs are kind of a part of the genre, right? When I, we talk about modern rock bands, and, I ask you to hum me an iconic riff. What are you going to think of? A lot of modern radio rock. All right, I'm going to go with radio rock, because I kind of assume that some of this, or most of this, was played on the radio, that it experienced some commercial success, which is why they are as large of songs as they are. And when I think of radio rock, I don't typically think of hard riffs like this. There's definitely some bands that still do it and still have that hard rock idea of creating signature riffs to each song, but I more so don't think of melody lines, but chord progressions with unique rhythmic elements to the chord progression that would diversify the different songs in their album, but not necessarily strong elements of melodic riffage. Not a melody that I would associate to the song. And it's interesting to think about how rock might have changed from the 70s and 80s to the 90s and 2000s, where melodic guitar writing stopped being a focal point of the composition that goes into a track, and chordal ideas ended up taking over as the predominant style of guitar playing. Interesting. the ties to hard rock here, we have the iconic riff. Even the vocal style has a bit of width to it, a lot of reverb, very 70s and 80s hard rock style of production on that. The drumming is very much staying on the metronome, but has these little embellishes. Actually, it has a lot of embellishing ideas, which again is very 70s, very 80s, very hard rock. You ensure that you keep the rhythm down, you keep the tempo and time signature going so that the listener can bob their head and move along with it, but you put in your little rolls or your embellishing ideas or your ornamentation throughout. You sprinkle it throughout, in this case, sprinkle it everywhere, to ensure that your drumming is unique and varied and doesn't get stagnant over time. Speaking of, I absolutely loved having... we're done with it. We're gonna finish that up, because I think I'm done making the comparisons to classic hard rock. I think they do a fantastic job of taking the ideas and modernizing them. Right, this feels like something that could have come out in the 70s and 80s. Could have come out just alongside all the other, major contributions to the genre, the popular hits. And the only thing that I think really roots it as a modern song is some of the production. And like we've talked about this week, most of that is just placing things in the sound sphere. We might touch on that in a little bit, though. I want to get to this third section in the track. So the structure of the song, as far as I saw it, was ABC, ABD. So we have verse, chorus, solo section, verse, chorus, outro, which was also a bit of a variation on the C that we saw, the third section, and a little bit of the vibes from the chorus kind of combined, and that created our outro. So I don't know if I necessarily want to give it its own section, its own D section, but I think it is different enough, even if it is borrowing vibes from sections we've heard, to warrant its own letter. So ABC, ABD, which is an interesting song structure. I don't think I've stated that specific combination before. It has an idea of linearity to it, but it also has a looping concept as well. Normally we see tighter loops, like when we have AB, AB, CB, right? We have this two section vamp. We have the A and then the B, and then the A and then the B, and then the C and then the B. We can group them up into these groups of two. So we have the AB, the CB, and it creates these tighter loops, right? We feel the cycle on a smaller idea. This puts it into three section groups. It adds a little bit more linearity to it. We have ABC, which feels very different for a lot of people who might be expecting the second verse to come in after the chorus. I actually found it very interesting that they went straight into the solo section. It works fairly well in the hard rock lens, but coming at it from a modern standpoint, I was really expecting that second verse to come in and for any solos to come in the bridge, right? Which would have come in after the second chorus. And they went straight into it, right? But I thought it was awesome how they introduced it as well. And I think this is what I wanted to bring up, is the drumming is fire throughout this whole song. And it's also the first instrument to solo. I love that. It doesn't come in after the guitar, right? The guitar is usually the lead solo instrument. Every rock band who has a solo has a guitar solo. If there's a bass solo, if there's a vocal solo, if there's a drum solo, it is usually alongside the guitar and after the guitar. It is not usually by itself. Very rarely will you hear a song have a drum solo and not a guitar solo. Like, the guitar is the prerequisite. If you have one, it's a guitar. If you have more than one, maybe somebody else can get a shot. Maybe it'll be another guitar solo. So to have them lead with the drums, phenomenal. Doesn't have to combat anything else. Doesn't have to come in with any ideas of competing with the guitar solo that just came before it. It can really just lead with what it does best and play a lot of stuff at the same time. And he does it. I absolutely love his precision that he showcased throughout with all those rolls, especially across the toms. The speed of his rolls, the cleanliness of his rolls, they are very, he has a lot of tight precision in his drumming. And he gets to showcase that in a bit of an extended fill here. It isn't a super long drum solo. I think it was maybe four bars, but it can be perceived as an extended fill. And then the bass gets to have the solo. Absolutely love it. The bass was tearing it up all throughout the song. You can feel a lot of that blues influence in the way that the bass line is written, just like stuff we've talked about all week. Very hard rock style of writing a bass line, very prominent and present and dominant in the mix as well, and has a strong element to adding to both the chordal and melodic structures of the track. And then we get to hear a phenomenal bass solo. Really loved it. Then the guitar finally gets to come in, and it feels like the guitar solo is actually cut short so that we can return to the verse. I think part of it was not necessarily that it was a guitar solo. It was more of a transitional idea to go back into the guitar-led riffing that happens in the verse. Which, again, I talked about, it's very rare for anybody to get a guitar solo or to get a solo before a guitarist. It's very rare for anybody to get a solo without a guitar solo in the song somewhere else. Here, I really think we heard a drum and a bass solo, and then the guitar wasn't really a solo. It was more of a transitional idea in, and I absolutely love how they had a solo section and kind of went against the grain and allowed two different instruments to, finally get the limelight a bit. Absolutely love that. We go back into the verse, we go back into the chorus, and we take this idea, this laid back idea in the chorus, and we inject a little bit of riffage into it, a little bit of speed and intensity, and we ride that out for our fourth unique section in the song. And I really like the vibes that they get here. I thought the chorus was serviceable, has a catchy melody in it, has a nice vibe created from the how the melody pairs with their chordal structure that they have going on. Everything just kind of works, feels nice, and it's very relaxing after the hard rock stuff that they have going in the verse. But I always felt like it needed something more, and I think that's where this D section comes in, where we get a little bit of riffage on top of that atmosphere, and I think it is phenomenal. I don't necessarily think the chorus needed to be this, but I'm glad that the chorus got a chance to evolve into this. And then we just see a bunch of rising intensity. The drums start playing heavy crash cymbal, just like really wailing on it on every single downbeat, even when the rest of the drums or the rest of the guitars aren't really playing anything. There's some empty space here, that crash cymbal on every hit, it is just piercing through that silence, or through that emptiness, I suppose, not necessarily silence, but emptiness. And we have all this driving intensity that brings us to the end, which kind of has this this nice little letdown there. I think the song's done phenomenally well. And then the production is the last thing that I think I want to talk about. And what I mean when I say that it has modern production, we talked a lot this week about new technology in the 70s and using it, right? Bands experimenting with some of this new technology like panning, stereo placement, all sorts of stuff. And one of the key elements to me for older production is having left and right pan guitars, which we hear all the time. That's pretty normal, but with no space between the panning and the center, which means that they are 100% panned to the side channels. There is so much dead space between the instruments on the side, which tend to be the guitars, and then the centered stuff, your drums, your bass, and your vocals. That's the more traditional setup. And it almost feels like, if you go back and listen to anything we've checked out this week, I don't remember, Cult of Personality, maybe not, but Black Dog, Iron Man, and Fireball, all three of those, the two guitars feel like they are so far away from everybody else that's centered. And I don't know if it was a technological limitation or if it was just considered the standard at the time. I don't know if they had the ability to fill in space and do partial panning. Like nowadays, you would normally pan those guitars about 60% left, 60% right, somewhere in that range, so that they appear to come from the left and right channels, but they're actually still a little bit in the center, so you get this nice filling up of the space. You don't have all this emptiness between your center channel and your side channels. It's kind of filled in with a varying volume. And that happens here. We have our side channel guitars, but they don't feel isolated from the rest of the group. That is the dead giveaway to me that this is a modern production. Now, that's not to say that nobody in the 70s or 80s was doing production like this. I don't know. Like I said, it might have been a technical limitation. It might have just been the standard, the way that all the producers were doing it, which means that somebody could have went against the grain and done it a more modern way. But consistently throughout, whenever I listen to older stuff that has panning in it, that is how the panning is done. It's 100% to the sides and then a center, and there's all this, there's this gap between everything. So, yep, that's the dead giveaway on the thing. And then we have the production on the vocals. Like I said, it has a nice reverb to it, nice width, kind of gives me like an Aussie vibe as far as the production goes. Really makes the vocals feel a little larger than life than they are. Which is kind of, that's a hard rock thing to do. I think if I went back and really tuned into the vocal production on all of these songs, I might even see a pattern there as well. So the lyrics, I'm seeing a pattern here, that's for sure. The lyrics are about finding a woman who... They're describing very like woodland witch-like. She wears a cloak of feathers. She has a chalice in her hands. Her face is hidden in shadows beneath a hood of quills. There's even one bit here that says, of owl and raven, of peacock and dove, of swan and sparrow, woven with her love. So this idea of concocting a potion, it sounds like... So it definitely sounds like some sort of witch of the wilds kind of idea. Lives off in the forest, creates potions, dresses entirely in animal skin and stuff, feathers. And of course, this woman is beautiful beyond belief, and she does not have the narrator's or any man's best interest in heart. She has ulterior motives to any sort of seduction or relationship that she gets into. Literally says that she'll take all that you offer until there's nothing left. So that's what the whole song's about. They spend like five stanzas describing what she looks like. And one stanza, which gets repeated a couple of times, saying that she'll take everything you have. That's it. She's beautiful and has ulterior motives. And man, if this doesn't sound a lot like Black Dog, if this doesn't sound a lot like Fireball, what was it with hard rock and making songs about women who could find domination over or could abuse men's lust and take them for a ride? Whether in Black Dog, it was about having the clout, I think it was, or taking his money. I don't remember, something along those lines. And Fireball, I don't remember what happened to Fireball. I just remember he found an alien on a hill. I don't remember if the woman in that story had ill intent or not. But yeah, so this femme fatale kind of overly sexy but will take advantage of men's lust idea seems to be very prevalent in this hard rock style. And yeah, man, the lyrics though. I didn't really notice this in Fireball or maybe Black Dog a little bit. But here, like I mentioned, the song kind of does two things. 80% of the time, it talks about her looks. The other 20% of the time, it just repeats that she's bad news. And to me, it makes for a boring lyrical set. It's very shallow, very one-dimensional. And I will say there are some interesting lines in here. Some of it's a bit cringy. As far as my taste in poetry goes. But, oh yeah, and then the one line of her making a potion. Forgot about that. There is a line about her doing something. a whole stanza of something that she did. Otherwise, it's describing how she looks and talking about her intentions. Or, I guess, how dangerous she is. Definitely an object of the story, and not necessarily anything with power, any sort of agency. But yeah, I don't know. I really dig the music. I do, and I don't know how the music lines up with the lyrics. They definitely had something in mind visually. The music video, I think, kind of lines up with a lot of this, with a lot of what the lyrics are doing, but the music seems to be divorced from it. I can't say there's any strong element of the music that lines up thematically with the lyrics. And I am a little bit disappointed with the lyrics. Usually I have something nice to say about them, but these lyrics just aren't for me, I suppose. But those are my thoughts on The Sword's Cloak of Feathers. Really dig the vibes they got going here with the music. Absolutely love the attention to detail with the bass and the drum, giving them solo sections. And yeah, I'm going to have to check out more of The Sword and see what else they're doing. This is where you guys come in, though. Hit me up in the comments. Let me know what's going on. Let me know what your thoughts are here. And, you know, for those who grew up with hard rock, maybe you were a teenager in the 70s and 80s and you kind of grew up around this music. How close does this feel to you? I'm still looking at hard rock through a modern lens, looking back at it retrospectively. So I'm seeing connections here that maybe people who grew up with it don't. Maybe there's elements of the original stuff that really stood out to you at the time or still stand out to you as predominant aspects of it that aren't being replicated in this modern take on it. When you're done commenting, you can head up to the description box and there's a link for Linktree. It takes you to this menu right here. It has everything related to the channel. You can join the Discord community. You can follow me on Twitter. You can support me through Patreon. You can pick up some merch. You can submit a special selection. There's just a bunch of stuff. Go ahead and check it out. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of those. We have one more video coming out today. Came out a minute ago. It's going to be our, Create a request where a band gets in contact with me. The band is called The Wind Covenant. I don't know what kind of genre it is. I don't know what we're getting into. So if you're intrigued, if you like to know about new music, smaller bands, go ahead and check that out. Otherwise, I'll be back on Monday at, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC. I think that's correct. I don't know. I know that daylight saving time is changing for me. I don't know how it's changing. Well, no, actually, that would be correct. Yeah. So 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC. I'm pretty sure that's accurate. If it's not, correct me. I'll make sure it's accurate for future videos. And we'll be doing whatever the next week's theme is. Oh, otherworldly music, I think. I don't remember. Check back Monday. It'll be a surprise. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to. And have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.